probably about 6-7 years ago, I was listening at night to this minister who was talking about how he visited a hospital for the mentally challenged. He called it an insane asylum. So he went there to visit, and when he first went into the hospital, a patient came up to him and said, "Do you know that I am the second son of God?" And the pastor said, "No, I didn't know that. How do you know that?" And the patient said, "Well, God told me." But then another patient from across the room said, "No, I didn't." I was listening to this at night, and I woke up my wife because I was laughing when I heard this. But, you know, this is the sort of thing that Christ is saying about himself. Mm. You know, it's that outrageous. You are claiming to be God in the flesh. And so you have all these great passages in the Bible that just make it so clear that he is claiming to be something more than a mere man.
Welcome back to On the Line. In today's episode, we sit down with David Thompson, who is the director of the Center for Apologetics and Worldview. In today's episode, he's going to talk about apologetics, which is really a defense of the faith. It's a way to understand the validity of the scriptures that we use as Christians, the validity of the claim that Jesus rose from the dead, and dealing with other criticisms or pushbacks that people who are not Christian make against the Christian faith. He lays out some very logical arguments, and he does this in a really profound way. So this is a very enjoyable interview. He'll also help you understand some of the worldviews, the ways that people that are not Christian understand the world that we live in. So very valuable interview. We very much appreciate Dave Thompson sitting down with us. As always, if you can like this video, leave a review. It is very helpful for getting this message out to more and more people. And as always, thank you for taking the time to learn alongside of me and alongside of our guests. Enjoy. All right, and Bennett says we are live.
Good.
Pastor David Thompson, Dr. David Thompson?
Pastor.
Pastor David Thompson? Yes. Okay, well, good to have you on.
It's good to be here. Thank you.
Yeah, I was excited. We connected over a couple things probably about a month or two ago, mm-hmm. Leading up to you had an apologetics conference at Mankato University. At Bethany University, which is located in Mankato.
Or college.
College, Bethany College. You're
calling me doctor, not quite. Calling Bethany a university, not quite.
Yes, yeah. Okay.
Thank you for the compliment, though.
Yeah, you bet. But yeah, so in fact, for those that watched the Adam Francisco interview where we talked about mm-hmm. Islam, mm-hmm. we recorded on your campus, mm-hmm. which you helped coordinate. So thank you for that.
You're welcome.
And you had a couple great speakers, and you were one of the speakers at the Apologetics Conference. So just had an absolutely great time there. So thank you for the hospitality. And with that, we're going to talk about apologetics today. So very excited for that. So you now sit in, correct me if I'm wrong, it's the chair of the Center for Apologetics and Worldview.
Right.
Is that
correct? The director.
The director.
For the Center for Apologetics and Worldviews, right.
And what is kind of the mission of what you guys are doing there?
So the mission of that organization is to simply put forth the evidence and encourage other Christians to put forth the evidence for the truth of Christianity, but also then to critique those worldviews that are at odds with Christianity. Mm-hmm. So we do both of those, and we do it in a variety of ways. So for example, we put on conferences, at least one conference a year, usually at Bethany Lutheran College. But we've also had conferences in the past too. In fact, a lot of the center dates back to about 2002, when I started holding conferences on worldviews up at Bethany Lutheran College's Retreat Center. And we had, you know, good conferences. And I continued to have those conferences after I left the Retreat Center. And I was in San Antonio for one of our conferences that we had there. And I think Adam Francisco might have been there at mm-hmm. that conference. And so at that particular conference there was the president of our synod who was there, John Mulsta Jr., and Pastor Jay Weber and a few others who were presenters. Chris Roseboro might have been there. I can't remember. But anyway, we just put our heads together and said, you know, we should kind of make this more of a permanent thing. And so mm-hmm. we thought of the idea of putting together a center. And so a few years later, we brought forth a motion to our synod convention to establish a center. That was in 2017. And actually 2017 is when we appointed an ad hoc committee on apologetics. And then the committee itself came back the next year proposing a center. And so the center was finally established then in the year 2020. So I'm of the Evangelical Lutheran Synod, a small little tiny synod, you might say.
ELS, right?
ELS, right. Mm-hmm. So, but we are the only synod that I know of right now, and I'm sure this is accurate, that has not only an apologetics board, but also a center to deal with apologetics. And but anyway, so throughout the years, and especially the last several years now, the center has put on conferences, and we've brought in a number of really good people from various synods, Missouri Synod, the Wells, the ELS, and even some other places too. And so we put on conferences. That's one of the things we do. But then we also have other resources. We put together Q&A questions that can be used as bulletin inserts. We have about 30-some questions that we try to answer.
And can you pull up the website real quick just so?
Yeah. And then we also have as resources articles and essays that were written by some of us or people maybe connected to us that we have on our website. And then if you look at our website too, we have, go ahead and Bennett, click on resources there.
So it's apologeticscenter.org, which we'll put that in the description as well. So those that are listening.
So we have what we call brief reads. Those are usually the Q&A that I was talking about, just one page questions and answers. Mm-hmm. And then we also have in brief reads, there are articles that are in our Lutheran Sentinel magazine. Mm-hmm. We have in-depth articles. For example, that's where you find the paper I wrote in 2019 for our General Pastoral Conference, mm-hmm. talking about what is Lutheran apologetics and how should we understand it.
Which we'll dive into that. So anyone that's kind of wondering
sure.
how Lutherans and apologetics go, we'll dive into that towards the end, yeah. Maybe an hour and a half in or so.
And then we have videos there you see. Mm-hmm. Those are videos of our recent conferences since 2018. I think there's about 10 of those conferences we have there recorded. And so people can go back and look at those. And then we have other things too. One of the new tabs we have there is called Worldview Watch. And so you can go ahead and click on that, Bennett, if you want to.
On the upper right there.
Yeah, at the very top right. And so we're just putting on there various articles and podcasts. And in fact, we're about to put on a couple from your podcast here now.
Thank you, yeah.
Yeah, you're welcome. And just a link to those. And so
you guys gave us a hero's welcome, by the way, at the conference.
Oh,
that blew us away. I was so humbled by that.
Well,
so
you're welcome.
You.
Yeah, it's well-deserved, though, too. So we just have on here various articles and podcasts and so forth that speak to the issues of today that we think Christians should be aware of to help them understand what is contrary to the biblical confessional Lutheran worldview, mm-hmm. and also just to help them to be aware of what's going on, to have have their radar up, so to speak. Mm-hmm. And these sorts of articles we think are very helpful. We draw from a variety of sources there. We you know, Issues, Etc. is one place. Mm-hmm. We and now your podcast and there's something called a Breakpoint, John Stone Street, the Colson Center. I don't know if you've heard of that.
Are they in California?
No.
No, okay, I'm thinking of somebody else.
But they're very insightful. So I use a number of their articles and other things too that we have on there just to help people be aware of what's going on mm-hmm. in the world. And so we can be on our guard, so to speak. And so that parents and grandparents and pastors can help protect the faith of children, grandchildren, and so forth. Because right now, as we know, so many people, especially young people, are being drawn away from a true Christian understanding of life and a Christian faith, being drawn away from Christ. Mm-hmm. So we think that sort of thing will be helpful. And then we have events up there too. And those events consist of the conferences we've had and also upcoming things. We have a few more things we're going to put up there under upcoming.
Like an apologetics youth retreat.
Yeah.
Some kind
yeah.
of things
so
like
it's,
that,
yeah. We're trying to do quite a bit and, hopefully we're not, overextending ourselves, but, we think it's very important mm-hmm. and necessary, just like apologetics was necessary in the first several centuries. You know, mm-hmm. it was just so, so important in these post-Christian days, where Christianity is at least, if not a name, in reality, a minority, mm-hmm. We just need to do battle as we ought to do, as Paul directs us to, and Christ directs us to as well, too. So anyway, that's kind of an overview of our center. It is a self-supporting center. We're mm-hmm. it's underneath our synod. Mm-hmm. So I have my office on the campus of Bethany Lutheran College, but we are a self-supporting center, and so we are dependent on donations, but we're doing okay. Mm-hmm. But we hope to keep going, and we want to invite others like what you're doing here and the other synods to take a more active role in apologetics. I know the Wisconsin Synod, they have something right now called the Institute for Lutheran Apologetics. Mm-hmm. And they meet once a year, and I think they're making some progress. One of the speakers we had at our conference was Professor Luke Thompson.
Yeah, who we hope to have on here.
Yeah, and he was great. He's so insightful. He's a real scholar, but he's kind of down to earth too. So mm-hmm. I really appreciate what he has done in the area of apologetics. So there we go.
Yeah, and I like the, just kind of as a plug for apologetics, you know, when we had Dr. Weinrich on, he made a good point, which I've leaned on even in some of my preaching. We had some stuff with the Book of Acts recently, and just kind of talked about the early church and how our church, for the first time in a very long time, looks a lot like the early church. Because for a while, we were very blessed that the West was Christian. So you raised your family, the culture was Christian. Didn't mean everyone mm-hmm. lived mm-hmm. fully Christian lives, but everyone was at least kind of in an agreed upon understanding that the things the Bible put forward were true, whether you liked it or not. Was kind of, there might be plurality there, but we now live in a time where the normal thought process, the normal person at the grocery store, the way that they think is secularized. And that was what the early church dealt with. And as you said, mm-hmm. when you read those church fathers, especially in the first 200 years, maybe 300 years, mm-hmm. they were apologetic by nature. They had mm-hmm. to articulate the Christian faith and try to have those eternal truths make sense to somebody who was coming from a completely different perspective. And they had to defend those mm-hmm. Christian claims. They weren't just self-evident. They couldn't say, well, the scriptures say so. And mm-hmm. then they would go, oh, I didn't know. That's not how it worked. They had to make sense of that and try to articulate that in a way. So it had to be very intellectual. Those Christians had to engage. They had to know their stuff. They had to kind of know the world around them. And we're at a time like that too, which is why something like apologetics and the center and everything that you guys are doing is so important, because it's very dangerous if you just kind of say, I'll just, my kids are just going to trust in the Christian faith as they get older, because they're going to, mm-hmm. they're going to need to at some point understand what these other ideologies and these other teachings are and be able to wrestle with those. And if you don't give them the tools and kind of train them to be thinkers of the Christian way, mm-hmm. then you're setting them up for some degree of failure.
Yeah. Sometimes I say, actually quite often I say, we have to let our children know and our grandchildren know that they are in a battle. It's not that they will be in a battle, but they are in a battle, and even more so today. When you think about what's going on with what we call the orders of creation, where did this come from? All of a sudden, these orders of creation, natural law, natural knowledge of God is kind of out the window mm-hmm. and within just a few years. And so what's going on? And so we have to prepare ourselves and our children for what's here right now.
Mm-hmm. So let's do this, because we definitely want to dive into some of these kind of mm-hmm. ways of articulating Christianity to the outside world, or defending against, secular type thinking that might kind of creep in, so we want to be able to talk through apologetics and how that plays out. But first, if you can just tell a little bit of your background, because I think your background is interesting and it helps give credence to, you understanding apologetics, because it had a big effect on you.
Yeah. I often say that I'm a victim of apologetics, because when I was I grew up in a, a Lutheran home, but it was in a very, very liberal Lutheran church, the LCA back then, which was, the most liberal of the three Lutheran synods that joined together in 1988, was it, to form the ELCA. Hmm. So I grew up in the LCA, and very good parents, wonderful parents, but we weren't always in tune to theological issues. So, for example, when I was in confirmation class, we never opened a catechism. Mm-hmm. So, we probably very rarely opened up a Bible, too. We just talked about issues and social issues and so forth. So, I received no good grounding for my Christian baptism, and then, as typical young people do, I was very attracted to certain sins. I got involved in sins and to start to love some sins. And I easily became an agnostic in my first part of my high school career. I had a great time in high school, in a sense, did a lot of fun things, did a lot of wild things, did a lot of sinful things. But I truly became an agnostic. And so my best friend from high school, even grade school, he lives near Chicago, where I came from recently. We got together, we were talking about all these wild things we did. And you know, most of them were kind of innocent, but some of them weren't. But his wife was with him, and his wife turned to him and said, "I can't believe that David Thompson became a pastor." So I have, you might call it an experience that some people don't have. Now, I should point out, too, that being reconverted to Christianity, in my case, is what you might call more dramatic. Mm-hmm. Not as dramatic as some, but probably more dramatic. But it's no more miraculous than anybody, because you know, it's all the work of the Holy Spirit. That's the bottom line. But anyway, so... when I was in high school, and this was St. Louis Park, Minnesota, a suburb of Minneapolis, we had a senior class of over 900, so a lot of people there, a lot of students. And in ninth grade, I started playing soccer, and 10th grade, 11th grade, finally, my senior year, I made it into varsity, but I never played. Mm-hmm. I hardly ever played, put it that way. Second to last game, the guy who was playing center defense messed up, so the coach told me to get in there. So I went in there and played, and I got Defensive Player of the Game Award, something like that. Mm-hmm. And the coach said to me, "You're going to start the next game." It was the last game of my season, my mm-hmm. senior year. So I got to start the very last game of my senior year. And again, I played well, and I got the same award again. And out in the crowd that night was a coach from a college, Bethany Lutheran College, Bethany Lutheran Junior College at the time. And he got in touch with me after the game, and he said, "Could I come over and talk to you and your parents about possibly coming to Bethany?" So we invited him over, and it was kind of a strange thing. You know, clearly I was an agnostic. I mean, not many people knew that, but I was. And so this coach, Mike Butterfield is his name, he came over. And the first thing he said, at least one of the first things he said was, he asked us two questions. And you can maybe guess what the questions are. If you died today, would you be sure of going to heaven? And then the second question is, if you did die and God said to you, "Why should I let you into my heaven?" what would you say? And I just thought, this guy is really, really strange. but anyway, he offered me a scholarship to come and play soccer at Bethany. Now, back then it was $250.
Yeah.
But it was enough to brag about to my friends and others. So I went to Bethany. I got onto campus, and the campus, the students and the professors were just as strange as this coach. Mm-hmm. Now, the majority of the students there believed that the Bible was true. The majority, I would say all of the professors believed that the Bible was inerrant and inspired. And I just thought these people were really, really strange. Back then, you had to attend chapel every day. Mm. And our coach, our soccer coach, would talk to us. He'd have a devotion. He'd have a prayer. We'd have to say the Lord's Prayer together before every game. You also had to take religion courses. Mm-hmm. And so the very first course I took was called The Case for Christianity. It was an apologetics course. Mm-hmm. And the professor who taught it is still my good friend today, Alan Quist. And he's on our board for apologetics still. But anyway, so it was... that class that introduced me to some of the arguments and some of the evidence in favor of Christianity. And, you know, we looked at, I think, C.S. Lewis, a little bit, Josh McDowell probably, and some mm-hmm. others too. But so I started thinking, you know, okay, what about this worldview I have? What about this philosophy, this so-called religion I think is correct, which was agnosticism, and which basically said, if there is a God, he's probably a combination of all the different religions. So that's where I was coming from at that time. But again, going to chapel, going to religion class, talking to fellow students, and I love to explore things, but I also like to debate. Mm-hmm. So I was arguing with students and sometimes a professor. I would go out and visit this one professor who was teaching my course quite often. And I'd go to chapel, and what would I hear there? I'd basically hear law and gospel. And so, even though I didn't know it at the time, there were two questions being asked of me, two major questions. One was, who am I? Okay. And second of all, who is Jesus Christ? Mm. So the apologetics at that time was making it quite clear that I am a great sinner. The law was telling me that all the time. But the apologetics and scripture and the professors and the students were also saying Jesus Christ is clearly who he claimed to be. And so I share this with people once in a while, not too often, but you know, I think these sorts of testimonies, maybe especially in our day and age, can be helpful to some people. But I remember very clearly one day, my freshman year, was during the Lent season. Most of the students were off at a at the church down the block from the college, attending the midweek Lent service, and I was wandering around a particular part of, well, it's now part of Bethany, but it used to belong to the city. And I just remember thinking, and the tears started coming, and I realized that I was a great sinner, and I realized that Christ was who he claimed to be, and that he did what Scripture said he did for me. And that moment is not the key thing, you know, but what that moment did and what was all those things did in combination, you might say, it brought me back to my baptism, my baptismal grace. And so, you know, it was kind of like, you might say, waking up from a dream. I think C.S. Lewis describes his conversion that way too, but waking up. And it was, you know, it was very moving. It was emotional. It doesn't have to be, but it was. And, but, you know, since that time, and what's more important, of course, than the emotion is the truth of Christianity. And so, you know, ever since that time, I've just been very, very zealous, you might say, for the subject of apologetics, and also very zealous concerning the understanding of worldviews, because that's kind of what I focused on ever since that time, and done some quite a bit of study, you know, on my own for the most part, and eventually led to the formulation, or led to putting on conferences, and then putting together a center, being on a board, first of all, and then being called to this position of director. By the way, when the center began, it was the first director was Ryan McPherson, who is now out at Luther Classical College. And he was there from 2020 to 2023. And then I was called, and I've been director now since February of 2024. So there's my story.
Yeah. It kind of reminds me of, I think, to your point of Lewis's conversion, right? His is very similar. I think he was walking in a garden. And there's some deeper things there about even things he had as a child. But the very simple thing is he says, I left an atheist and I returned a Christian.
Yep.
And it was like an hour, you know. Now there was years leading up to this and debates with Tolkien and all this kind
14
of stuff.
Years, I think. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. But yeah, very similar. Was it, you left an agnostic and you returned a Christian?
Yeah.
Is that how that walk went?
Yeah. Something like that. Yeah.
Yeah. That's cool.
I mean, there was such a clear change. I'm not going to say it's instantaneous, because it was, in one sense, it was gradual, but all of a sudden my outlook on life was significantly different. Mm-hmm. Just to give you one example. So again, I loved adventure. I loved challenges. And when I was in high school, I would go out to the mountains and go backpacking, and my goal was to conquer, you know, conquer those mountains, conquer that trail. And that's the way I looked at it. And then that changed. You know, I still love the adventure. I still love the challenge, but there's a thing of beauty now there. There's an aesthetic thing that always accompanies when I look at the sublime. Okay. So it's a wonderful thing.
Yeah. That in some ways reminds me, my story is not your story. And I grew up in a good LCMS, you know, household. My father was a pastor, and, you know, a great pastor and a great father. And those things are not always the same thing. And he managed both very well. But like most kids, you know, certainly in high school, well, to some degree in high school, but certainly once I went off to college, I like the way you put that. You know, I found sins that I enjoyed. and that starts to, it does start to cloud your mind, you know, and I don't think I ever reached a point where I would have said, Jesus is not Christ, but I was certainly in an area where that claim was not very important to me one way or the other in the way that I live my life or the way that I engage with sins. But I do remember one night where I felt like I was engaging in some sins with some friends and, I felt a little bit of a weight. So I was like, I'm going to go. And I just, you know, went up to my room and then for whatever reason, I don't know why, but I picked up The Great Divorce and I read that whole thing all the way through and things shifted for me in reading The Great Divorce. And that's part of the reason I love Lewis so much was he spoke to me via that book. And then I started to look into other books and I can't say that I woke up the next morning, I'm sure the next morning, but I can't say that that was like a shift in my life where all of a sudden it was like a new Brian, but there were lingering ideas, almost like a virus in my mind that kind of kept playing out. And that's, and eventually it took over my mind and caused, you know, good shifts in my life. And here I am. But, I think most people go through something of that sort.
They do. Yes, they do.
So, and I'm sure everyone listening right now can remember certain points where they were probably, sin always plays a role, right? Sin does a good job of clouding the mind. And then there's times where clarity breaks through. And it's amazing in those moments where you always say, don't lose this, because you see something and you're like, don't forget this, you know? And those are, there's a lot of moments of that where you see something and you're like, this is really important. Don't forget this picture that you have or this idea that you have. And then life goes on and it starts to go away and then it comes back. And that's just kind of the way it goes. Sin's always trying to pull you away from goodness, truth, and beauty.
Yeah. And that's why the wonderful thing about being a biblical Lutheran is, you know, the grace of God is always there right in front of us, offered and distributed to us on a daily basis. And we know too, as biblical Christians, that right underneath our skin is the flesh, you know, it's right there. And so it's just a beautiful and wonderful thing to be a confessional Lutheran.
Yeah. Well said. So let me ask you this, kind of two questions. Let's do the second one in my mind. So there were arguments that were being made, certainly within your the kind of apologetics class that you were taking. What arguments were really strong in kind of forcing you to question things or bringing you to Christianity?
You're asking me to go back quite a ways with my mind and my memory, but I would say that one thing that was there very clearly was what C.S. Lewis experienced too, you know, Who is this man? And so C.S. Lewis clearly points out in Mere Christianity, you know, it's really foolish for somebody to say about Christ he was simply a great man. You know, the historical accounts in the Gospels, they don't leave that open to us, and purposely so. You know, when you look at the claims of Christ, and this is something I often do when I'm using apologetics and evangelizing somebody. I go to the claims of Christ in the Gospels and point out, and I don't say this to people specifically, but you know, if you look at the four Gospels in the Gospel of Matthew, I think there are 46 times where there's a fairly or maybe extreme outrageous claim that Christ makes about himself. Okay, in the Gospel of Mark, I think it's 36. In the Gospel of Luke, it's 70. In the Gospel of John, over 100 times there are these outrageous claims made by Christ about who he is. And so, you know, you don't look at these claims and say, oh, he's a good man. He's a good moral teacher. He's a good religious guy. No. And the people of that time understood that these were outrageous claims. So you look at the Jews who opposed him and they said, he's blaspheming or he's insane, or he's possessed by a devil. I mean, those were the three things they made. Sometimes they combined two of those together. But based on his claims about himself, this is what their conclusion was. And if you think about it, it's quite reasonable. I mean, it's much more reasonable than saying, oh, he's a great man, but just a man. No, either he has to be insane, or he has to be possessed, or he has to be a blasphemer, or he has to be exactly who he claimed to be. Those are really the only legitimate claims. And so, you know, this is the sort of thing I was confronted with when I first came to Bethany and was taking religion courses, talking to professors and others. And And so if a person is going to make these claims, or these claims are going to be made about somebody, these sorts of claims, then you have to ask the question, well, is there evidence for this, for these outrageous claims? One of the stories I like to tell is that this was from a podcast probably about 6-7 years ago. I was listening at night to this minister who was talking about how he visited a hospital for the mentally challenged. He called it an insane asylum. So he went there to visit, and when he first went into the hospital, a patient came up to him and said, "Do you know that I am the second son of God?" And the pastor said, "No, I didn't know that. How do you know that?" And the patient said, "Well, God told me." But then another patient from across the room said, "No, I didn't." I was listening to this at night, and I woke up my wife because I was laughing when I heard this. But, you know, this is the sort of thing that Christ is saying about himself. Mm. You know, it's that outrageous. You are claiming to be God in the flesh. And so you have all these great passages in the Bible that just make it so clear that he is claiming to be something more than a mere man. And in fact, one of the things that you find in Scripture, one of the main questions that's being thrown out there in the Gospels is, who is this guy? So, you know, Jesus said, who do people claim that I am? Who do you disciples claim that I am? Who do you think that I am? Or you have, when he's on the Sea of Galilee, and there's the storm, and he falls asleep, and then he gets up, and he calms the sea, and the disciples ask the question, who is this man that even the waves and the sea obey him? And then, of course, you have other questions very similar that those who opposed him were saying, who do you claim to be? Who do you think you are? Where did you get this authority? And I think that one of the best examples of this is in John 18 and 19, where Jesus is brought before Pilate. And when they bring him before Pilate, they have one main charge. They have a couple charges, but one main charge. Pilate, he claims to be a king. So Pilate goes and talks to Jesus. Are you a king? And Jesus finally says, I am a king, but I am a king from a different world. I am a king from a different place. So then Pilate goes back out to the Jews and says, not guilty. But Pilate, you just heard him say he's a king. Yeah, I heard him say that, but I also heard him say he's a king from a different world. So I believe, my interpretation of that is that Pilate was saying, this man's insane. Mm-hmm. Of course, Pilate was a little more concerned later on when he found out he claimed to be the son of God. But, you know, Pilate did not find, you know, if Jesus was claiming to be a king in the sense that would have been against the law, then he would have been put to death because that would have been Pilate's responsibility. Nobody could set himself up as a king in the Roman Empire without permission from the Caesar. Mm. And Caesar would give certain people the right to become kings within his empire, but he had to give the permission. And Pilate said, this man doesn't fall into that category. He's not trying to be a king in any worldly sense. He's just mentally deranged. Again, my interpretation. So anyway, so this is one of the things I was confronted with when I went to Bethany and have thought about over the years, and I use from time to time to help people understand the truth about who Jesus Christ truly is, or who they should at least start thinking about him as who he is. I would also have to say that at Bethany, when I was there, besides looking at the evidence, and again, Josh McDowell, I knew it was used, mm-hmm. besides C.S. Lewis. It's really hard to argue against some of these points that are made, but I would especially say this is the case when it comes to Scripture itself, the Gospels themselves, and also Acts and certain epistles too, the evidence they put forth for the truth of Christianity. But along with that too, you know, I just had these very, very kind professors and, classmates at Bethany too, who were very kind and patient and put up with put up with quite a bit from me and put up with my attitude at times. And of course, that made all the difference in the world as well, too. But then the bottom line is the law was there and the pure gospel. Mm-hmm. And it was that gospel itself that was used as what the confessions call the efficient cause in changing a black heart to a white heart, from bringing me from an enemy to God to a friend, from making me, to taking me from being spiritually dead to being spiritually alive. So
I think that's a really potent argument, because, and we'll explore in a little bit. I kind of want to just pose some kind of questions from that, mm-hmm. that people have, and then we can kind of go through how you would think through those. But one that you certainly get a lot is this idea of all religions are kind of the same. And like you said, Jesus was a great man. Mm-hmm. I like your Jesus. You know, I'm glad that you get good inspiration from him. But once you kind of have this exclusive claim of him being the Messiah or him being the Son of God, mm-hmm. that's where people push back. And to your point, there's just no way you can read the scriptures and come to that conclusion, which of course, most people that are doing this, maybe they grew up, you know, in the faith and they dabbled in the scriptures, but most of them have not seriously read the scriptures, you know, to wrestle with things like what you put forward. I mean, mm-hmm. over 100 in the book of John. And that's where I do like the way that Lewis kind of brings that conclusion. He says, you've got three options. You can dismiss him as insane. You can nail him as a cross because he's a demon or a blasphemer, or you can bow down and worship him. But in the end, those are the three. And people like to live in the gray area where they can say, I like your Jesus. He has no claims on my life. I can go do what I want. I certainly mm-hmm. don't have to bow down, but he's nice. And it's, you fall into one of those three camps if you're approaching the scriptures with any, if you're really engaging the scriptures, those are your only three options.
Yeah. And that reminds me too, and maybe this has happened with you too, but in speaking to Muslims from time to time, they have tried to convince me that they believe in Jesus too. Mm-hmm. So, I have to convince them, no, we believe in a different Jesus. It's not mm-hmm. the same. And I've been somewhat successful in convincing them that we believe in a different Jesus than they do, but it's kind of a challenge. And so, one of the things I sometimes do is, go to this claim about, is he God? Okay. We believe that this Jesus we believe in is God. Mm-hmm. Do you believe that? No. I go, okay. So, but maybe we don't believe in the same Jesus. And they kind of get that too. Another way I describe it is by saying, you're talking with some other individual and you're talking about John Smith. And the other person says, oh, I know John Smith. And so you think you have a real connection there because you both know John Smith. But then as the conversation goes on, the John Smith he's describing is not the same John Smith I know. And so at some point you have to realize and say, we don't know the same John Smith. Mm-hmm. The same with belief in Jesus. You believe in Jesus? Well, sorry, it's not the same Jesus I believe in. The one you believe in is not going to do anything for you in the end, you know, mm-hmm. but this one does.
Yeah. I forget who it was. It was some Eastern philosopher, you know, but he said, he was asked, what's the one most important thing for education? And he said, the most important thing is that a word means what a word means. Right. Mm-hmm. And we saw this because we just released the Francisco video this week, you know, with Islam. We've had a lot of comments and whatnot, or just engagement, mostly from Muslims, you know, but one or two of the comments said something along these lines. And they said, the Christians believe in God and Islam, they believe in God too. They just use the word Allah, but they're talking about the same thing. And that's the reverse of what the reality is. Because the reality is you can say God and I can say God, mm-hmm. but to your point, what's your definition of God? And if they're two different things, it doesn't matter that you're using the same word. You're talking about two very different ideas and concepts. And that's the core of when you get to different religions, you know, the Jews might say God, you know, and they might even say Yahweh. Mm-hmm. The Christians might use the word God. The Muslims might use the word God. Buddhists might use the word God, you know, but they're all talking about very different things. So to try to lump them all in is kind of a failure of education and a failure of intellect, but yeah. It's just not even honest.
And it's not only in the area of religion, but today, especially it's in the area of critical theory, cultural Marxism. And they're taking these very good words that, you know, and they're redefining them all over the place. There's conflation, there's redefinition. And unfortunately, Christians don't understand that these words have been redefined. These good words, sometimes biblical words, mm-hmm. have been redefined by culture, by their education, by their courses and so forth. And it's a very serious thing. And Satan knows exactly what he's doing. You know, mm-hmm. he knows what he's doing. And so we just have to be on guard. That's why we have our worldview aspect to our center too.
Can you speak some more to that? Because I think that's an important idea. Just kind of the struggle that people have with words like maybe justice mm-hmm. or equality or things like that, that are good words, but then if they get twisted, or marriage, right? And if it gets twisted, it becomes something different. So how do you see that issue playing out in our time?
Yeah, I came across this back in around the year 2000, 2001. Let's see if I can remember correctly now. It was, the word tolerance. Mm-hmm. And a person I was working with at the time, he was speaking on education in Minnesota and also throughout the country too, but he pointed out that the word tolerance had changed. You know, it used to mean simply to put up with another, even though you disagree with them. Okay. The Webster Dictionary added a definition to that word. It also now means respect for not only the person, but respect for what the other person believes. Mm. So when you tolerate something now in our new postmodern woke culture, tolerance means that you are not only to put up with them, but also to respect what he believes. Well, respect implies some sort of acceptance or affirmation. So again, it's a very dangerous thing when we start saying, well, we will tolerate this, not realizing that tolerance now has this new element to it. And same thing with the other words that you pointed out too, whether it be justice, affirmation, marriage, you point out to, you know, it's, you know, again, marriage is just, it's so sad. I mean, we have a whole generation of people now growing up only knowing the new definition of marriage, mm-hmm. you know, and not understanding that there is a created order regarding marriage. There is a divine understanding of marriage, and that is the only one that really should hold water. So now, with postmodernism and wokeism, we have this understanding that marriage is a social construct. And if you look at the what the Supreme Court wrote back in 2015 in Obergefell, they basically say marriage is a human construction, mm-hmm. so we can do with it as we please. Some people say, well, we can still hold on to our definition. And that's true. We can, and we should, we need to, and we need to hold on to it tightly. But we also have to understand that as this is going on in culture, it's affecting individuals, it's affecting churches, it's affecting schools. And the bottom line is that it's not true. Mm-hmm. And we ask ourselves, well, if it's not true, where does it come from? Well, where do all lies come from? They come from Satan. Mm-hmm. He knows exactly what he's doing. And so he's using these lies, whether they're big ones or little ones, and embedding them and infiltrating various aspects of culture so that eventually they're believed even by good Christians. And little by little, they can be drawn away from Christ. So yeah, it's so important that we as Christians know that this is going on, but also we then carefully explain what these words should mean to one another, to our children, to our grandchildren. One of the great things about the Lutheran confessions is that we have what we call theses and antitheses. Mm-hmm. These are both extremely important. Theses are what we believe and confess, and antitheses are what we reject. If we only have theses, which are necessary, it's not good enough just to have theses. We need to have the antitheses. We have to know what we reject too. And the reason I say that is because, as you know, sinful human beings or human beings who don't think as clearly as we should, we'd always make the connection between this is what we believe and therefore this is what we reject. We need some time to have it explained to us what we reject. Because it's too easy, I think, in my opinion, to say, yeah, we believe this, this, and this. But if we don't also understand that that means we reject this, this, and this, it can be a dangerous thing. And we used to, I think we've kind of lost that art a little bit of theses and antitheses.
Probably because of the tolerance you're talking about, right?
Yeah, exactly. Good point. Yeah. And so, you know, this is one reason that, that I'm encouraging our Lutheran church bodies, and I don't know what the Missouri Synod has done with this lately, but, you know, to put out clear theses and antitheses on current worldviews, especially on what we call cultural Marxism, critical theory, whatever you want to call it. We need to know what we believe regarding this, or where we might agree with them even sometime, but also what we reject in these areas. And so I hope we can do that in the near future.
I do know in the Wyoming district that they are working on that with Marxism right now.
Yes.
I've got Jacob Benson. He's been on twice, actually. I don't know if his second one will be released yet, but yes, it will, because it's next week. But I know he's working on a part of it, and there's a group of, it's a pretty strong group of people that are doing exactly what you're talking about to help define that.
Yeah, I think the district president, Southern Minnesota, he wrote something.
On critical race theory, he did.
Yeah.
Yeah, Lucas Woodford.
Yes, yes. Good.
Yeah. Yeah, I think your point's really important. I'm thinking of, you know, so what a thesis would be something like God is love, you know, and that's a pretty abstract thesis, but that's a biblical statement, right? But unless if you define what you don't mean by that, that, you know, that's put on posters all over the place in yards where it'll say love is love, you know, which isn't exactly the same thing. It's actually very different in the way that they bring it out, where they basically turn love into something like universal acceptance of all modes of living your life. But that's where, if you just leave it as God is love, and, you know, a child or a high schooler kind of takes that and they say, well, God is love. And then they start coming across these more Marxist, you know, and progressive ideas. They'll say, oh, you're using love too. So we're all talking about the same thing. The antithesis helps them so that they can say, wait a second, you're actually speaking in the way that we reject, and gives them some articulation about that matter. And that's very important to do.
It is. Good. Very good. Yes.
So let me ask you, I want to get into worldview and kind of talk about what are some of the prevailing worldviews and how do we understand them. But before that, I'm just going to throw a couple kind of apologetic questions at you. And I know you could answer all of these, but if there's one where you go, ah, I don't know if that's in my wheelhouse, feel free to just say pass. But here's one, and that is, you know, the resurrection of Jesus Christ. So Paul says, if Jesus does not rise from the dead, we Christians are most of all to be pitied, right? Because we're way off. We're very foolish if Jesus did not rise from the dead. So how do we know that Jesus rose from the dead, or why do you have confidence in that claim?
Yeah. So there's two ways that maybe Christians could answer or do answer that question. And the one way is simply to say, well, the Bible says so. Okay. Is that a legitimate answer? Yes, it is. But I would say it's not always the best answer depending on who you're talking to. One of the reasons we had our conference and had Adam Francisco speak is because he talked about the historical reliability of the gospel accounts.
That was actually going to be my next question. So which order? Would you like to say the validity of the scriptures, or would you like to go Christ, the resurrection, or do you want to weave the two? What's the best way?
I'll try to weave them together, and then if I'm missing something, you just ask the question.
And just explain kind of that question too. So we've got the, does Christ rise from the dead? Which of course our primary sources are going to be the scriptures. And then the other question is, and I'll hear this a lot. I mean, Joe Rogan, for instance, you know, I listen to him and, you know, some of the guests he has on, whenever it comes up to the reliability of the scriptures, that's where they go, not a chance. In other words, what we read when we open the Bible and we go to Luke or we go to Acts or whatever, when we read something, is that even what was actually maybe written, you know, in that first century?
Yeah.
Or is there any reason we should trust that? Or is this something that was written way later and it's written by people that aren't witnessing something like the resurrection or the early church, but rather they've got agendas and they want to write documents to help push their agenda forward so that they can maybe keep power, or, you know, that's very much a Marxist kind of understanding of these things. So that's where a lot of people come from, and where they say, you've got your scriptures, but those things have been just completely you know, it's just littered with propaganda and ulterior motives and all of that. So that's what you're saying. That's not true. And here's why, when you talk about the validity of the scriptures.
Yeah. So let me begin with a reliability question and explain it perhaps as best I can. Realizing that I'm not quite totally prepared to answer that maybe as carefully as I should, but I think I can do an adequate job because I've had to answer it before and I have actually written on it. But so one of the best ways to approach this question is to ask ourselves, do we have the original manuscripts? And no, we don't. We don't have the original writings dating from the first century, but we do have copies or copies of copies that date from at least the second century AD. And so those are good to have. Now, the question regarding those copies of copies and copies, you know, how many do we have and how close are they to the original writings? And so when you look at that, those questions, the answers are quite amazing. You have something like 5,000 copies or manuscripts, as we call them, dating from the second century through the fifth, sixth century, Greek manuscripts. You know, 5,000. And, you know, you compare that number to other works of antiquity.
And real quick, if I remember right from Francisco's presentation, if you go into the other languages like Syriac and Aramaic and Latin, then the number gets closer to 25,000.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. Yeah. I mean, there's no religion like Christianity, which has recorded its scriptures over and over and over again, you know? So we have, okay, these other works of antiquity, you know, whether you're talking about...
like the Iliad, isn't that a big one?
Yeah, and Homer and Aristotle and Plato and later than that, and even Josephus and so forth, you know, they have very few. Mm-hmm. Manuscripts. I mean, we're talking about usually maybe, I think there's one that maybe has quite a few, maybe 1,000, but other than that, it's like 20 or fewer. Mm-hmm. Okay. And so that's one
Bennett,
thing.
Can you look up real quick, just so we can maybe reference back to this, but just Google, I mean, there's pictures of it. I remember Francisco kind of put it even in pictures, but you can either do pictures or numbers as far as comparing, I think at least the Gospels, comparing the manuscripts of the Gospels to other historical writings.
Yeah.
And you should get, I think, probably a pretty good easy document that'll say how much for Homer and whatnot, because it is quite profound, these numbers.
I've got a graph too describing that too I could share with you. But so besides these thousands of copies we have, the next question is, you know, how close are they, were they copied after the originals? And how does that compare to other works of antiquity?
Okay, let's see here. Nice. So we'll just go. So it's, some of you might be able to see this if you're watching on YouTube. If you're listening, you won't be able to see it. But so you've got from authors like Lucretius, am I pronouncing that correctly? Some Plato, all of these other kind of authors that are big. So I'm just going to go, it goes down the list from kind of least to most. The New Testament's going to be in the most. The next one up is going to be Homer's Iliad. Okay. So we'll just use that. So that was written in 900 BC. The earliest copy that was found was 400, or that we still have, is 400 BC. So that's a 500-year gap, okay? And the number of copies is 643, okay? So we've got 643 copies still today. The one that goes the furthest back, it's a 500-year gap. All the other ones are much less than that, significantly less. In fact, when you go to Plato, you're looking at a 1,200-year gap between when Plato wrote to the earliest copy. Let me say that again, 1,200 years. And there's only 7 copies that we have, okay? And this is, I mean, now we've got millions that are printed, but we're talking about, you know, the ones that go back. Does anyone out there go, well, I don't think that Plato was a real person and I don't think his writings are accurate? No, we use them in all, I mean, every college is going to use those and they don't doubt that.
Yeah.
But we're basing that off of a 1,200-year gap and 7 copies, and we can feel confident. And we actually should feel confident, and there's reasons for that. But real quick, just, you go to the New Testament, you've got less than 100 years. So remember, Homer's 500, Plato's 1200, and you've got less than 100 years for the oldest ones that are still remaining, and you have 5,600 copies. And once again, that's just a Greek. If you go to other languages, it gets closer to 2,500. So that's not a small jump. If you're going to believe anything that is from the ancient world, that there's any accuracy, the New Testament blows everything else out of the water.
Yeah.
So if you don't want to believe the New Testament, the very least thing you need to do if you're going to at least have integrity is say, I don't believe anything.
Ben, keep it up there just for a second. I want to explain a couple of other things too. So you have the numbers, okay, the number of copies, and then you have the time span in between the copies and the original. And again, we blow these other things out of the water, as you say. The other thing to point out here too is I usually talk about the telephone game, mm-hmm. where you know you have 5, 6, 12 people in a circle, and the first person says a sentence to the person next to him, whispers it, and then that person whispers it to the next person, next person, next person, next person, next person. Finally, comes to the last person, and that last person has to say what they heard, and inevitably, that one sentence has been changed drastically. Mm-hmm. And so we get a big chuckle out of it. It's kind of fun. Okay. And so people say, well, see, that's what we have with the New Testament too. We have all these copies written over all these years. And therefore, obviously, there's going to be some huge differences. Okay. So let's look at the earliest copies and compare them to the later copies. Okay. What do you find? No differences. Okay. Well, some people point out, well, you have errors in these copies. Yeah, you have some errors because they're human beings who made the copies, so there are going to be some errors. But the question is, what kind of errors are they? Well, they're very insignificant errors. Just to give you one example, maybe the earlier copy says, he did this. And then a later copy says, Jesus did this. Well, in either case, you know he's referring to Jesus. Mm-hmm. But those are the sorts of errors we're looking at, which are of no significance at all. So you look at that last column there, the New Testament again, go all the way over to the right side, the accuracy of copies. That 99.5%, and I've heard anywhere from 98.9 to 99.5% accuracy. This is a statistic put together based on certain tests that historical critics use to figure out whether these documents are accurate. These copies are accurate. Do they reflect what the original actually said? And these historical critics, used in a good sense, they've put together these tests. These are not Christians. Mm-hmm. I would guess that most of them are not Christians anyway, but these are secular critics who are saying, hey, we've got these tests. We can be sure we have an accurate wording of what was really written originally to 99%, okay? So it's just, okay, so we're getting back to the question of reliability. Are these scriptures that we have reliable? Obviously they are. We're not trying to convince a person initially that the Bible and the New Testament is inspired and inerrant. What we want to, and it is, mm-hmm. but we want to at least have them understand that they're reliable. Mm-hmm. And the other thing you could say about the reliability of the letters and the Gospels is that they're clearly not written in the language of myth or legend or fiction. You know, once upon a time in a land far, far away. You don't have any language of that sort anywhere in the Gospels. You have a specific time. You have Caesar Augustus. You have Tiberius. You have Pilate. You have Herod Agrippa. You have all these people dating it at a specific time. And then you have specific places, Jerusalem, Rome, Caesarea, Galilee. You know, it's not written as fiction or legend whatsoever. And then you also have some other very interesting little details, but that lend credence to the fact that, hey, these are historic documents and they're reliable. So, for example, I think it's at the end of Mark, where you have when Jesus is arrested and the disciples run away, and the one man is, they grab him, but he leaves his coat behind and he runs away naked. Why in the world is that there? Well, if anything, it just says somebody knows what's going on. You don't include these sorts of things if you're trying to make up a story that's not true, you know? And you have all kinds of these little facts included in the Gospels that just really lend credence to the reliability question.
Well, I know C.S. Lewis talks about that last point, you know, and he was a professor of, I think, like literature, and particularly, I think, Renaissance literature, certainly like in the medieval times also. He understands fiction and literature. In fact, that was a big point that Tolkien had to really grasp was, or speak to, was Lewis's understanding of myth. Mm-hmm. And that's a whole kind of a side thing as far as kind of leading to Lewis's conversion. But point being that he would be a world expert in what is fiction, you know, the different types of literature throughout all of the ages. And he says, one of the problems that we have nowadays is that we have types of books like Dan Brown's, right? Where it's a story and it puts it in a place like Italy, and it describes the characters in detail, and it tells you about, you know, their thoughts, and it kind of walks, and it looks like real life, but it's a made up story, right? And Lewis says, we have those now, but those didn't come about until I think like the 18th century or the 19th century. He says, that's never been a type of literature, right? So he says, the Gospels are written as if they're real events. And he says, if they're writing that as fiction, it's the only document in all of history before the 18th century that does that, right? So he's saying there's all fiction in the Old Testament, or in the old times, were written, like if you read Greek mythologies and things like that, they're obviously, they'll talk about these grandiose things that are just, you know, larger than life, like, you know, Prometheus, slaying Uranus and, you know, cutting off his testicles and all this kind of like crazy stuff. Point being, the way that the scriptures are written, once again, just very reliable, and they're written as history, and they're written as eyewitness accounts, and any attempts of trying to turn that into something else it's certainly not an informed point of view. I think it's an ill-informed point of view.
Yeah. So good. So then we can go to the question of your first question then, the resurrection, right? Mm-hmm. So you have these documents, these historical documents that are at least in some sense reliable, okay? And when you look at what even the opponents of Christianity will say, you know, they agree on a number of things. They all agree that there was a Jesus who really lived. Most of them agree that he was crucified at the time that it was said to he was crucified. They say that he was put in a tomb. They say the body was missing. And then so the question is, well, what happened to the body? And so you have what? You have different theories. And I won't say too much about the specific theories, except for maybe one I'll talk about in a little more detail. But the interesting thing about these theories, other than what the Gospels say is true, all these other theories, whether you're talking about going to the wrong tomb, or the disciples had these hallucinations, which is just, that would be a miracle in itself. But all of these theories, with the exception of one, have no historical basis to them. They're all theories, but nothing more than theories. No evidence for them, historically speaking, whatsoever. So one of the ways, just to help people understand that these theories are in all likelihood not accurate, of course I believe they're not accurate at all, is to say, do you have any historical basis for these? And the answer is no, there is none. Throughout history, there is no historical basis for any of these, with the exception of the one, and that's the stolen body. Okay? You have that recorded in Matthew. So, according to Matthew, the soldiers go and report to their authorities that the body was missing. And so they said, well, let's make up a story that the disciples came and stole the body. Okay? Well, let's just pretend that's true for a little bit. And I like to have some fun with this one. So here's what would have had to happen. The disciples who were living in fear and huddled together in a house were talking about this, and maybe Peter got up and said, "All right, men, let's pull ourselves together and make the best out of a really bad thing. We know he's dead, but let's go there tonight and steal the body." And that means we have to go there and be very quiet because you have these Roman guards there, the best trained guards in the world. We have to be very quiet so we don't wake them. And then we have to remove the stone, which weighs at least a ton, maybe 2 tons, without making a noise, okay? Then we have to go in there and steal the body. And while we're there, we're going to take the claws and we're going to fold them up nice and neat, take our time. And then we're going to sneak out of there without making a noise so we don't wake up the guards, okay? And then we have to get rid of the body. We have to put it somewhere, okay? But then we also have to come up with a bunch of stories that more or less agree with one another about what happened, about this resurrection. And so you two, Cleopas and your friend there, you make up the story that you encountered him on the road to Emmaus. And Mary, you talk about how you met him outside of the tomb and you other women. And I'm going to, Peter, I'm going to make up a story too, how I met him. And we're going to come up with at least 11 stories that more or less agree with one another. And then, and here's the kicker. We have to be willing to go out there and convince people that he rose from the dead, even though we know he didn't. And not only do we have to go out there and convince people that he rose from the dead, which we know is a lie, we have to be willing to die for it. Mm. People die for a lie. Many times, but they don't die for something they know to be a lie. Mm. So Muslims will die for their faith. They believe it's true. They don't know it's a lie. A lot of people will die for a lie, but they don't know what they're dying for is a lie. They think it's true. If anybody would have known that Jesus did not rise from the dead, it would have been the disciples. And you do not die for something you know to be a lie. I can think of maybe one exception to that, but, you know, all of these apostles, with the exception of John, and then not to mention all the other early followers of Jesus who saw him alive after he was dead, willing to die for a lie, you know, at some point, word would get out, hey, these people, they really don't believe that. So again, I think there's just overwhelming evidence from that perspective that this man really rose from the dead. If he rose from the dead, what does that mean? Well, it means that he is who he claimed to be. Mm. And not only that, but it means that what he did 3 days earlier worked. He has bought forgiveness of all sins. Mm. And this is what I like to do with people too. I love to go to the claims of Christ, give them the evidence for the claims of Christ, talk about the resurrection and how we can be sure that these accounts are reliable. And then what I like to do with them is I want to bring them back to the cross. Because what does the cross say? Why in the world would this man who claimed to be the Son of God, who proved himself to be the Son of God with his miracles and with his resurrection, with the eyewitnesses, with the fulfillment of prophecy, why would he die? What does that say? Well, first of all, it means that sin is very real. Second, it means that sin is very serious. Your sin is very serious. My sin is very serious. Third, it means that sin is really forgiven. Mm. And so this is the great value of apologetics. When it's done right, it always points back to Christ crucified for the sins of the world. Mm. And this is what I try to do when I evangelize and talk to people and use apologetics. Mm.
That was beautifully stated.
Thank you.
Yeah. One thought as you're going through, right? Well, C.S. Lewis, in fact, I got a clock that's broken, but it still is up in my office. And it's a quote from C.S. Lewis where he says, faith is the art of holding on to what your reason has once accepted despite your changing moods. And I forget what book it is where he kind of hashes that out. But he says what he found was when he especially throughout his conversion process, when he had to really think about and wrestle with these claims, Christianity logically won out. It was the only logical conclusion he could come to when he would look at the evidence. He found that his doubts that he would have, both before and after, were not based on new evidence or ever based on logic, but they were based on his changing moods. Like maybe he wanted to go do something that he knew he wasn't supposed to, and so he would reverse rationalize that maybe there wasn't a God, right? Or he would feel fearful. And because he felt fearful, he would say, well, what if there isn't a God, right? So it was his emotions that were always rising up and attacking his reason. Mm-hmm. But he found that his reason was, whenever he just uses reason, Christianity made perfect sense for him. So I like that example. But because as you're talking through that, right, you're saying this is the best, and you're right, and we don't have the time to go into this, all these different theories that were out there that are, mm-hmm. are really kind of asinine in many ways. You presented kind of the best one, which is that stolen body, you know, or that the scriptures aren't reliable, which we've kind of already dealt with. But as you're going through that, why would all the guards be asleep when their actual job is to be guarding this tomb? And how would they sneak past and remove a one or two ton rock and fold the cloths and lay them there as they steal a body, which is would have to be just an absolute mess after a crucifix? All of this, them dying, I think that's one of the best arguments. Who's going to really say that that's more logical than all of the evidence just saying maybe he did rise from the dead, mm-hmm. right? But once again, the people that will argue against, they'll usually say, well, we've got logic and science on our side and history on our side, and you've got kind of fairy tales on yours. And it's not the case. It really mm-hmm. isn't the case. And so many people are often just fearfully moved towards agnosticism, where they're like, Christianity is a bunch of fairy tales and children's stories and VBS, and that's as far as it goes, and I've been hoodwinked. But they don't actually go through the process of doing what you've just done, which is what everyone should be exposed to some degree.
Yeah. And when you talk about C.S. Lewis and his emotions and his moods and so forth, it reminds me a little bit of the way Lutherans talk about enthusiasm, mm-hmm. where unfortunately, Christians can be directed not by good thinking or the clear words of scripture, but their feelings, what they sense in any particular moment. And so we've always tried to guard against that. And at the same time, we haven't denied that our emotions are very real, mm-hmm. you know, but it's kind of like reason. We talk about the ministerial use of reason versus the magisterial, where reason has to be servant of scripture. Same thing with our emotions too. They cannot be that which directs us. They have to be a servant to the clear words and teachings of scripture.
Mm-hmm. Which I like. I think it's St. Anselm who has a quote where he says, you must believe and then you'll understand, right? Which is the way it always works, right? I mean, if you're going to do mathematics, at some point you have to believe that 1 + 1 = 2. Or plug in, what's the guy's name? Terrence Howard's 1 × 1 = 1 or whatever. I don't know if it's been a whole... Terrence Howard was on Joe Rogan and was questioning some mathematical basis. It's been very entertaining. But anyway, you do have to believe that 1 + 1 = 2. And once you do that, you can do arithmetic. Mm-hmm. But at some point you have to take a jump of faith on something that can't be proven, which that's a whole mathematical thing. But that's how things work. At some point I have to believe that my wife loves me, which I cannot empirically prove, right? I think Peter Kreef puts it this way. He's like, if someone came to my house and said, you know, I want you to know, and Peter Kreef's in like his 80s or something. Do you know Peter Kreef? He's brilliant. He's a Catholic. He's a philosopher. He's at Boston College, I think. Boston College.
Oh, yeah, I do.
Yeah, beautiful man. Very beautiful man. But he says, okay, well, if someone comes to your house or to my house and were to say, just so you know, your wife has been a Russian spy this whole time, you know, and he would say, I want to buy it, right? And his whole point is, because he's experienced the relationship and because he knows who she is, because he knows, he can actually explain and understand who his wife is. But the relationship has to come first, and then the knowing of the wife, if that makes sense. Mm-hmm. And he says it's the same thing, to where at some point you have to put faith in God and in the scriptures, and then the things start to make sense and come together. But if you don't ever take that first step, then things don't actually end up kind of lining up, if that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. He explained it way better than I did.
Yeah, I'm thinking too of how Luke introduces his gospel, and whether or not there's a conflict here, I don't know, but he says he's done all this investigation, and he says to Theophilus, so that you may know with certainty the things that you have been taught, something like that.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So I'm just wondering how that might play in too, but I'll have to think about that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and they're coming at it, I think, from a couple different angles, but mm-hmm. yeah. So let's move to the worldview aspect, right? Okay. I think you laid forward probably some of the best apologetic arguments, and there's plenty more, and there's plenty of books. You mentioned Josh McDowell. There's Lee Strobel's Case for Christ.
Mm-hmm.
N.T. Wright's The Resurrection of the Son of God, which I have not read, but everyone who has read it, their eyes get really wide when they talk about it. They're like, holy cow.
Which book is that?
N.T. Wright's The Resurrection of the Son of God. There's C.S. Lewis, there's Timothy Keller. So a lot of good resources out there for those that want to kind of dive into a book. But I want to reference this book that you've got over here, which you wrote, What in the World is Going On? Identifying Hollow and Deceptive, I think it says worldviews.
Yep.
So how should somebody understand the prevailing worldviews of our time? What do those look like?
Yeah. Well, what I do in that book, by the way, that came out in 2010, so it's a little bit dated. It's still selling, but it's a little bit dated. And there's one thing that's definitely missing in that book that needs to be included if I come out with a second edition. But so what I do in that book is I first of all put forth why we have to understand worldviews, because there are many out there that are deceptive and hollow. And I give an example right away in the first part of the book. The example has to do with my daughter when she was a senior in high school, I think it was, and she got together with a bunch of her friends, and they were talking about going to watch the new movie that was just coming out, Brokeback Mountain.
Mm-hmm. I remember that.
Homosexual movie. And so my daughter explained to her friends, one of them was a pastor's daughter too, I think an ELCA pastor's daughter. My daughter explained to them her view on homosexuality, and they asked her the question, are you homophobic? And so where did that question come from? Well, it came because they had adopted a particular worldview that they didn't know was in conflict with the Christian biblical worldview. And obviously it was affecting their outlook on that particular subject. And so a worldview is, as many people describe it, is like putting on a pair of glasses, and that's how you see the world. You put on one pair of glasses and you see the world one way. You put on a different pair of glasses with a different strength to them or a darker color, you see the world in a different way. And so the goal for the Christian is always to put on a pair of confessional Lutheran biblical worldview glasses and wear them consistently. Mm-hmm. Now, we don't do that, but that's the goal, and we should try to, and we can do so better and better as time goes on. So in the first part of the book there, I explain what is the biblical worldview and how does it answer a number of these important questions. And then I go on from there to talk about three other fairly popular worldviews back in 2010, and they're still popular today. And one we call modernism or naturalism, the view that the only thing that really exists is matter. There's nothing supernatural. There's no spiritual itself and so forth. And then the second worldview I talk about is postmodernism. And that's very, very prominent today. What I didn't realize back then is that postmodernism is going to be quickly surpassed by what I call postmodernism on steroids, and that's cultural Marxism or mm-hmm. critical theory. So if this book is ever updated, it has to include a chapter on that particular worldview. And then the other worldview I touch upon, I call by various names paganism, which would include pantheism and so forth, which again, it is on the rise in our culture today. When you think about it, when Christianity was a minority religion, it was this pantheism, this paganism that was prevalent everywhere at the time, along with certain, philosophies and so forth. But that was something that Christianity had to defend itself against back then in those first several centuries. And again, it's very popular today. It's very popular in certain countries, like, you know, India is just, you know, pantheistic, and there's the American version of pantheism too, but paganism, just raw paganism, and the occult is I believe something that is coming back into vogue to a large degree, along with and it's closely connected with cultural Marxism and wokeism too. There may these are all religions in one sense or another. But anyway, that's what I try to do in this book, is try to explain these worldviews and what they say, what their assumptions are to some degree, and the responsibility we have to compare them to the way that Christianity answers the important questions. Mm-hmm. And what the assumptions or the basic principles of Christianity are. Mm-hmm. So again, that's the book I wrote.
Could we dive into one or two? So I'm thinking, like, so paganism, I think we certainly did a deep dive of that with John D. Davidson when he was on.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
If you want to know more about paganism, you can go check out, there's two interviews with John D. Davidson. One, first one's Pagan America. The second one's AI, C.S. Lewis and Tolkien, which is our second one. So there's that one. Which one of the first two, or even critical theory, or Marx, cultural Marxism, if you think those are the best, but which one would be a good one to kind of dissect what that worldview is and then how Christianity interacts with that?
Well, postmodernism, which I subtitle here, I see neo-Marxism. So I was kind of catching on at that time that, hey, we're heading in that direction. And one of the things I do in this chapter, and I've already explained one aspect of it, the redefinition of tolerance, you know, mm-hmm. which was a big factor. The other thing I do when I talk about it, I spend some time on this. I talk about social constructionism, and the way I explain that, and I think this helps people understand what's going on, is that as people made in the image of God in the wide sense, you know, we have these attributes that are somewhat similar to God mm-hmm. because we're made in his image. One of the things that we are able to do because we are made in his image, we are able to, you might say, create or construct things, okay? And we do that legitimately. We create baseball teams. We create cities. We construct clubs of various kinds. You know, this is what we do as human beings made in the image of God. It's natural for us, you know? But at the same time, we have generally said in our society, until more recently, we have generally said, or at least acknowledged, maybe if not directly, at least indirectly, that there are certain things that we do not construct that belong to God. They're divinely constructed. Okay? Mm-hmm. So I say, imagine two bins. One's called divinely constructed and one's called humanly constructed. And we can put a bunch of things into this humanly constructed bin, legitimately so, okay? Mm-hmm. We're human beings. That's what we do. We construct things, okay? But into this divinely constructed bin, God has put certain things that he says are his. So marriage, okay? Mm-hmm. Morality, true religion, and a number of other things. They are his. But what's happened in our society over the last 20, 40, 50 years is we've taken things out of this divinely constructed bin and put them in this humanly constructed bin. Mm. And again, the prime example is the Obergefell decision in 2015, where the Supreme Court said, hey, this is marriage is a human thing that we can define and construct. So it really belongs in this bin over here. And of course, that's devastating. And I think just understanding that can be very helpful to people to figure out and to know what's going on in our society. That, hey, this has been going on. And I've noticed that's helped a lot of people. One of the other things I've done more recently.
Real quick, if I can just, that was a very good explanation. I love the box analogy. I'm going to use that, especially with our youth and even high school. So funny, this morning I was reading an excursus on Genesis 2, I guess, or Genesis 3, kind of the fall into sin. It was by Bishop Barron, who's a Catholic bishop, actually here in Minnesota, not in Rochester. Mm-hmm. And he explained a lot of what you were just talking about. And he basically said, we have to first acknowledge that when God tells Adam and Eve, now you tend to the garden, or you go and subdue creation, that he's giving creative empowerment mm-hmm. over. Mm-hmm. So he says Christians always, and this, he's kind of pushing back against a puritanical type thing. Like we do appreciate the quest for knowledge, you know, the quest for intellect, you know, good, you know, universities came out of the Christian tradition in the West. So we want those kind of things. We're fine with striving towards technology in a healthy way and constructing roads and figuring out, you know, ways to help with health, you know. So the ingenuity of man we can appreciate. And I like you're basically saying that's this box over here. Mm-hmm. He says, but in the fall, what we're being told is there is this certain area which is God's, and we are designed that we must receive that through him, that we are designed to have a relationship with him. We can go create these things, but we are still below him and receiving these certain objective divine things that we only receive through him. And going to the tree of the knowledge and the good and evil is an attempt to usurp God and say, we don't need God. We can go define these divine box things, and we can go do that on our own. And that is when the whole process falls apart, right? That's when the being kicked out of the garden and everything starts to crumble, because you've broken the foundation. And once you break the foundation, everything else is going to crumble as well. But that foundation belongs to God. And then he does give creative power over, you know, mm-hmm. It's like there's only one thing he told them they can't do. He was not an overbearing God. He said, here you go. You can name them. You can tend to it. You can do all of this. Just don't eat of this one thing, mm-hmm. you know? And mm-hmm. of course, because if you do that, the whole thing becomes poisoned.
Yeah. Yeah. Just imagine all the trees they could eat from. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Someday though, we'll be there.
Someday. Yeah. Yeah.
That reminds me too, I can't remember the exact year. It might've been back in 2014. I was traveling from Texas up to Minnesota here. We were going to have our general pastoral conference, and I was going to deliver a paper on, I think it was kind of an update on worldviews. And as I was traveling through Texas, I came to the city where is Baylor University? I can't remember, but Baylor had a big sign up, and it just hit me. I said, what in the world? And it just had two words on it: create knowledge. That's postmodernism. Here's a Christian university saying you can come here and you can create knowledge. You know, it used to be that you would go to college and the university to discover knowledge, not to create knowledge, not to construct things. And so, I mean, that's just a clear indication that even these Christian universities, I don't think they kept it up that long, maybe they got some flack, but they're influenced by these worldviews. And often it's not necessarily the people who are the professors and teachers. Sometimes it might be the admissions department that, hey, this sounds pretty good. Let's advertise in this way. We might attract some people here. But so anyway, the other thing I was going to point to was I wrote something a couple years ago on identity, just a simple way for Christians to understand this whole craze with identity now. And I put into three categories. One is God-ordained identities. Mm-hmm. So he created us male, female. He created us in his image in a wide sense, but he also created us in his image in a narrow sense, but we lost that righteousness totally, completely. And so this is how God says we are to identify. And you can put into that category also things like, you know, these vocations, father, mother, and so forth. So these are legitimate ways and right ways we are to identify. And then we come to a category of identity that you might put in the category of adiaphora, optional, okay? We can identify as American. We can identify as black. We can identify as white. We can identify as short, as tall, you know? And why? Because, well, there's some objective truth to those things, right? Mm-hmm.
The danger, a Michigan fan, not an Ohio State fan. He can't do that.
Yeah, well, that might fall into one of that first category.
Yeah, so. Yeah.
Or sorry, maybe the third category, which we'll get to in a second. But the problem with that middle category is that what we have done, being the sinful creatures that we are, if we have taken those things in that second category, which are optional, Mm-hmm. And we've kind of put them into the first category sometimes. Mm. And we say, I am white. I am therefore better, you know, mm-hmm. than somebody who's not white. Mm-hmm. Okay. Or even nationality, you know. And that's the sort of thing that leads to what we typically call racism, you know, mm-hmm. where we take those in that second category and put them into a different category where they don't belong. And then there's a third category, which we call God-forbidden identities. And that's where we get into trouble today, of course, where males identify as females and God says, no. So it's just a nice way to help Christians understand this identity phase we're in right now, this identity craze. And ultimately, of course, our greatest identity, which goes in the first category, is we identify as Christians, as those who have been bought by Christ, the redeemed, and we are his. We identify as Christians. And so that's just the most valuable and by far the most important identity.
Mm-hmm. That's, once again, that's a great illustration with those three boxes. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
Let's do one more on this, because I do want to hear your thoughts on neo-Marxism. And we've probably dabbled at least a little bit, but how should someone understand the dangers of Marxism? And maybe I can just give a kind of a quick illustration that's helped me not understand it, but just understand the potency of it. That the way things work is they start in with kind of the philosophers, then they move to the universities, and then they move to the supermarket. So point being, at some point in history, there were philosophers that were entertaining new worldviews or ways of looking at the world. And at a certain point, things like Marxism started to win out in those philosophical circles, so they got introduced to the universities. And then those with tenure taught those ideas, mm-hmm. and students and even other kind of professors were then indoctrinated in those ideas. And then they go out into the workplace and they become fathers and mothers and middle school teachers and all of this. Mm-hmm. And then all of a sudden kids are, from the get-go, being formed by those philosophies that at one point were being debated by just a couple people. So what we have now is that at one point, Marxism was a new idea that was in a very small circle. And now if you go interact with, you know, a 17-year-old Mall of America, they are fully a Marxist. And it's just because they've been indoctrinated within this. But those are not self-evident ideas, or it's not a self-evident worldview, even though it plays out that way. Everyone naturally falls into Marxism, mm-hmm. but these were once debated ideas. Mm-hmm. So what is that idea that's come through, you know, via Marxism?
It's interesting. I just listened to another podcast, and there's a very interesting book out there. I think it's called The Devil and Marx.
Mm-hmm.
And the author of that book, I can't remember his name right now. He was recently interviewed by Jordan Peterson.
Mm.
It was a fascinating interview, in my opinion, just absolutely fascinating, because there clearly was a connection that Marx had with Satan.
Mm.
And that explains quite a bit, if you think about it. You know, again, Satan, what is he? Well, he's a murderer and he's a liar, okay? So Marxism obviously is a lie in many ways. Where did it come from? Well, ultimately, it always comes from Satan, the father of lies. But so Marx was not a real popular guy in his day and age. He was really a strange character, very messy, very dirty, very immoral. But he had an idea. And it didn't get very far in his day and age. And he was hoping it would take hold in Germany, but it didn't. And then it finally took hold in Russia and the Soviet Union and so forth, and then China and then other places. But it was all by force, of course.
Mm-hmm.
But people, even if it's done by force, can begin to adopt an ideology. And many people did. But Marxism at its root is anti-God, it's anti-Christian, it's atheistic, it's anti-humanity in so many ways, not acknowledging the dignity of man and the sacredness of man as an individual and in other ways too. But as we know, economic Marxism lasted less than a century, mm-hmm. we would say. But then we have what we call cultural Marxism. So Marxism, you might say, never really disappeared. It just appears now in a different form, what we call sometimes cultural Marxism or neo-Marxism, as I called it in my book. The person who's usually attributed for that mainly is Antonio Gramsci, who lived in Italy and realized that economic Marxism wasn't going anywhere. So what we have to do is we have to infiltrate those other places of society where we can have more of a say, where we can have more of a voice, especially in the area of education. And so what he thought was also then being promoted by a school of philosophers and professors in Germany who during the reign of Hitler left, and I think they settled in Switzerland for a while, but then they came to Columbia University. Mm. They're thinking, and they brought with them this idea of cultural Marxism and the importance of that being taught in the universities and the colleges, and then eventually trickle down to the other educational institutions, to the high schools and middle schools and even grade schools and so forth. And not only there, but also other places as well that have some degree, into law, into politics, mm-hmm. into court decisions. And so it's a fascinating study in and of itself. And so one of the places it's clearly revealed today, well, it's several places, but a critical race theory when it comes to ethnicity. and that's just a very interesting study in and of itself, that development. But also it's clearly revealed in the LGBTQ movement. Mm-hmm. I'll just point out one thing there that it's important to understand. When I was talking about this in a class in Lombard, Illinois, where I was a pastor, one of our high school students pointed out that as far as she knew, in every classroom, they had the LGBTQ flag or banner.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What does that say? Well, it doesn't say nothing. It says something.
Mm.
And it probably says there's this LGBTQ ideology being promoted. Being affirmed, being advocated, and it's absolutely true. And again, what they do is they take terms that we sometimes love, justice or whatever, and they redefine them so they mean something different. And so, let's see, I lost a point. I was going to make a point here, but I think it's just important to realize that, yeah, cultural Marxism, or whatever you want to call it, you can call it wokeism, they're all related, CRT, they're all have some common ingredients that date back to Karl Marx and what he came up with originally. And as you know, and I think John Davidson went into this too, there's this power mentality, this victimization mentality. Either you're a victimizer or you're a victim, and that's how they approach all of life, the proletariat and the bourgeoisie. And today, there's this binary thing that's coming into play everywhere, male, female, heterosexual, homosexual, transgender, non-transgender, cisgender, whatever you might call it. And the thing is, there's always some truth to this power thing,
mm-hmm.
in life. You know, we're fallen victims, and we like to have power over others. But at the same time, not all power is sinful. We talk about authority as Lutherans, and authority is a very legitimate thing. We need to maintain that this authority is good and right and God-pleasing, whatever that might be, and whether it be father, mother, and government and so forth, police, governor, president, you know, those are legitimate authorities. But what's happened with cultural Marxism is that all authority now is at least questioned and considered to be maybe evil in some sense, especially if that power is held by a certain race or ethnicity or a certain sex, if that sex It has that authority. It's a power thing. They're making women to be victims. Again, there's always some truth to these things. Mm-hmm. And so we have to kind of ferret out the truth from the error and maintain what is good and right. The other thing I would say too, and this is a little bit off the top of my head, we hear a lot about privilege today. Mm-hmm. And privilege is almost always has a negative connotation connected to it. Mm-hmm. As Christians, we have to realize that what is classified as privilege in a negative way is simply a blessing from God. Mm. So being brought up in a two-parent family, they're going to have some advantages, great advantages. They're going to have some blessings that unfortunately others do not. You know, it's sad. And those people who don't have a father at home or a father present, they've got to strike against them, and we got to try to help them. But again, God's design is to have two parents, father and a mother. And when that does take place and father and mother are fulfilling their roles relatively well, then there's going to be blessings or what we might call privileges. Mm-hmm. And so we have to just make a distinction there too, where not all privileges are bad and are only the possessions of people who might have some sort of power in society. You know, sometimes it's just a matter of either people being brought up in a good family or working hard or whatever it might be. So I kind of went in different directions there.
No, that was helpful. Let me ask one more question on that one, yep. And then we can take a break. How much do you, you mentioned, you know, I'm assuming a public school, you know, with kind of the trans or mm-hmm. LGBTQ flag. So obviously, and anyone that's been following this podcast knows, like, if you go to the public school, this type of Marxism, neo-Marxism, wokeism is woven into everything that's there. So they're set up to indoctrinate in this way of thinking. How much, though, is that type of thinking woven into the curriculum itself or the structure of the curriculum itself to where even at like a Christian school that still starts with the idea, let's go with Minnesota State standards and then go from there. How much of that is inherently woven in there? Mm-hmm. Or can you still kind of keep that system, but run a classroom in like a certain Christian way, or, you know, have a chapel service or, you know, something like that. Can you,